Okay, everyone, I think we're gonna get started. Good morning, hello. Hi, I'm Melissa Orkin, welcome to Tufts. Thanks so much for coming out on this beautiful Friday to talk about reading. We are really excited to see you. I'm glad you made it from the long trek from the parking lot. I was very concerned about you. I sent maps, I sent reminders, I'm so glad they worked out. Thank you, thank you. So we are here to talk about screening and intervention, and we have a wonderful day of speakers planned. Just a few logistical pieces, as Nancy said before, we are gonna be having lunch over, lunch will be distributed over at the Granoff Music Center in the lobby. There are tables set up there, but you can also meander around campus. We're gonna have an hour for lunch, so plenty of time to stretch your legs. The bathrooms are in the back to the right. If you want to use the Wi-Fi network, there should be a guest wireless password for Tufts. I'm sorry, a guest wireless account. There's no password for it, just a guest account that is for anyone visiting the campus. All of the slides will be made available to you. I'm gonna send you all a link to like a Dropbox account so you can access the slides and the handouts. We have a selected number of the handouts printed. They will be available where you're getting your lunch, so feel free to pick those up. But if you think that you could use an electronic copy, then save the paper as well. Anything else that I wanna tell you about logistics? I think that is it. Okay, so let's get started. So it is amazing that you are all here as reading teachers because not a single one of you or a single one of your students is born to read. You don't have a single neuron, a single gene that is specifically designed for reading. Reading is a cultural invention that happened about 7,000 years ago, and every single person in this room and every single one of your students has to build the reading circuit from scratch. So the work that you're doing is hard, and it's labored, and it is so critical because when you become a mature reader, reading is the single most important skill for learning. You read words in about 300 milliseconds. I can't speak that quickly. So reading is the key tool for learning new content. So we thank you for coming here today to try and further improve your knowledge, your toolbox of reading strategies. And there are a number of different organizations that made this day possible. I want to thank Decoding Dyslexia. As Nancy Duggan just said, they are a group of parents and researchers and practitioners who are looking to change legislation around literacy. They are a national organization in every state, or almost every state has their own chapter. The Massachusetts chapter is very active. Many members are here today, including volunteers. And if you want to learn more, you can visit their website. I want to thank Commonwealth Learning. Commonwealth Learning is a great resource in the community. Not only do they offer on-site professional development in literacy practices, but they also have a number of online modules for those of you who are looking to develop your expertise in a particular area. So Commonwealth Learning also has a website, and they'll have some information over at the Music Center. Stand for Children is a great organization that's working hard to close the achievement gap and ensuring that every child reads. Thank you for your sponsorship. Rasso's Grill and Pizzeria has prepared our lunch. Thank you, Rasso's, for your generosity. And finally, thank you, Tufts, for hosting this lovely event for us. So the schedule of our day, we are gonna have a morning session and an afternoon session. So in the morning, Dr. Nadine Gaab is here and she's gonna be starting our talk, and she is one of the foremost researchers on neuroscience and the behavioral markers of dyslexia. She's gonna be sharing with you what she's learned from her research and from the developments in the field and what the implications are for educational practice. I'm gonna be talking a bit about intervention, what intervention can look like, what a assessment schedule might look like, and specifically what your tier two routines will look like, what your extra support routines might look like. We're gonna have lunch. And then we have a panel of practitioners from the field. We have Michelle Taylor from Carver Public Schools. She's the director of literacy. Darcy Burns, who's the director of the Hill for Literacy and has worked with a number of different school districts, both in Massachusetts and New England. They're going to be talking about their experiences putting an assessment and intervention framework into practice and sharing what they've learned from that experience. Jennifer Traverso is the ELA coordinator in the Westford Public Schools. She's also going to be talking about lessons learned and what this assessment and intervention looks like in her district. And finally, Rebecca Brand is a literacy coach in Marblehead Public Schools, and she'll be talking specifically about different teaching routines. She is a coach, so she'll be talking about how she leverages her knowledge to collaborate with different educators in her schools. As I was reading the slides from the panel, in particular, I asked them to share their lessons learned from this experience. And something that came up again and again as a common theme was the importance of collaboration and the importance of consistency and the importance of an overall structure or framework that's being used across a district. And it reminded me that no one learns to read in a silo, except maybe Charlotte from Charlotte's Web. We don't learn to read in isolation, and we don't teach reading in isolation. Yet, sometimes when we think about our roles as educators or as administrators, we think of them in these very compartmentalized terms. So for example, a classroom teacher might think that supporting their students in their grade is within their domain, and yet being able to impact students in different grades, either in the grades lower than them or in the grades higher than them, is outside of their domain. Whereas a specialist might know that they're able to provide specialized instruction across grade levels and impact a variety of ages, and yet they're limited in terms of, or they might think that they're limited in terms of what they can impact at the classroom level, especially to ensure continuity of skills or prevention of reading disabilities. And then finally, administrators might feel that they can provide the structure, the overarching high-level pieces that are going to support Tier 1 through 3 instruction, like developing a routine for data meetings and planning and scheduling, but they might feel limited in their ability to actually carry out the instruction. What does this look like in practice? Now, this kind of siloed phenomenon really has some significant limitations, especially if we are trying to achieve this very ambitious but doable goal of getting 90 to 95% of students achieving literacy skills. So there's a number of different studies that have shown that when intervention is well designed, when early screening is in place, we can get the vast majority of children reading at grade level. And that includes children who are diagnosed with learning disabilities. But it won't happen if everyone is just doing compartmentalized work. What we need to do is we need to recognize that literacy happens in a system. And that system means that every single player is affecting one another. It starts with the child. It starts with what the child is bringing to your classroom, their genes, their genetics. Some children are genetically predisposed to struggle with reading. Their SES background, the resources that their family can provide for them or that their family is struggling to provide. The traits, their behavior regulation, are they able to sit and sustain their attention or are they having trouble? The next level is the role of the classroom teacher and the specialist. These are the people who are having direct impact on the student. So as educators, your approaches, your pre-service training, your in-service training, the tools that you've developed, your experience with working with a variety of different children, either with different SES backgrounds or with different learning styles, this is all going to impact your instruction. And furthermore, the children that are coming into your classroom are going to impact your instruction, and your approach is going to impact their learning. So you see that these different circles are permeable. They're not fixed. This information is flowing back and forth through these. And then for administrators, administrators are impacting both teachers and students at a higher level. They're scheduling literacy blocks. They're determining how resources are going to be allocated. They're thinking about professional development, when it's going to happen, how often it's going to happen. Is it going to be a stand and deliver? Is it going to be ongoing coaching? They're thinking about team meetings. How often are faculty getting together to confer? They're thinking about assessment coverage. What happens when you need to test 23 students? Who's covering your class? How easy is that process for you to carry out? And then finally, at the district level, there are the policies and procedures that are set for the entire town, the values of the district, and also the funding that's made available for everyone to improve their literacy practices. Your ability to carry out your job is limited to some degree because you're within a system. And in order for you to make substantial change in your practices, it has to happen throughout the system. As a teacher, what you can do at this point is you can inform yourself about explicit reading instruction. If you are a classroom teacher in K-5 school, you should know the 6-syllable types of language. Even if you're not a reading specialist, you should know the critical components of reading instruction. You should know how to describe what a syllable is, what a vowel is, what a consonant is. Even if you're in 5th grade and you're working primarily on comprehension, all of this knowledge should be part of your practitioner toolbox. If you're a reading specialist, it's important to inform yourself about how different students might need different services. Not just kids who have phonics weaknesses. What about children with working memory weaknesses? What about children who are just struggling with fluency? What about children who have fluency issues and working memory and oral language? How are you going to address those kids? And also, how can you leverage your knowledge to coach your colleagues, to collaborate with your colleagues? Because you are a holder of a specialized skills, and you want to be able to share that information. And then finally, administrators want to think about the district values and the district goals. What are the resources that you have at your disposal? Where can you leverage resources, and where might there be gaps in your resources? And finally, how can you make data-driven decisions for your district? These are big, complicated questions. You're here today, and that is fantastic, and we're going to be imparting a lot of knowledge to you, but change will not happen from an isolated one-time workshop. And you should not feel frustrated if you go back and try to bring about change in your district and it doesn't happen. Because real change at a system level takes 3 to 5 years. It is an involved and complex process. And it requires the leverage of all stakeholders. There's a really wonderful book if you're interested in thinking more deeply about this or bringing this to your colleagues. It's called Leading Literacy Change. One of the authors is actually going to be on our panel. Her name is Darcy Burns. She's from the Hill for Literacy. She helps school districts go through this process. So she can talk more about this if you're interested. But the book is like $20, $30, and it is a workbook that walks you through how to think more deeply about these really big questions. But of course, knowledge is the beginning. So I want to start with Dr. Gaab. She's going to be imparting quite a bit of knowledge to you about how the brain works for reading, what the early precursors are for later reading struggles, and what you can do as educators with this information. So, Nadine?
Okay, I'm Nadine, and I know a lot of you, not all of you. So what I will try to cover this morning is why should we screen, whom should we screen, where should we screen, and how should we screen, okay? But I want to start with a background on the reading brain, reading development in general, so that we get a foundation and empower you if you want to make arguments in your districts or to colleagues, et cetera. So this is a very rough timeline of typical screening development, and a lot of people, when you ask them, think that reading development starts in preschool, or maybe a little bit earlier. But actually, reading development starts in utero. It starts with language development. It starts with auditory processing. It starts with visual processing. Okay? So that's why we have here, I don't think this is working. The sound and language processing and the visual processing in infancy. And then in preschool, early kindergarten, you have phonological processing, phonological awareness, so the ability to manipulate the sounds of language. And we have letter recognition, which is important. Are these letters or numbers? Are the letters upright or the other way around, upside down, etc.? And then you slowly start in kindergarten, maybe first grade, and that's very fluid across languages and districts, of course, the grapheme-phoneme mapping, where you map the phonemes of language or the sound of language onto the written counterpart. Then you start reading single words, you start reading sentences and connect the text, and then the ultimate goal of reading is reading complex text, reading it fluently and actually comprehending what you read. So we have a shift from learning to read to reading to learn. At about third grade, fourth grade, maybe a little bit earlier, also depends on the history of reading instruction. So it's important that the foundation skills are in place before this shift occurs, because then it can affect a lot of the other subjects that the child is supposed to learn. So this is a very famous slide. I like it because it complements this one here. So it's not just the reading or the mapping that we need in order to become successful readers. No, you have these skills, like I said, phonological awareness, decoding, sight recognition, that are increasingly automatic. But then you have all these language comprehension, all language comprehension pieces that are really, really important, such as language structures, vocabulary, background knowledge, et cetera. And that becomes increasingly strategic, so it is woven into this strong string of successful reading. So I want to do a short excurse on the brain so you are all on the same level, because I don't know when your last biology class was, maybe in high school, maybe in college. All right, so this is the brain, and you see the brain from the left-hand side. This is the front here, this is the back, this is the top, and this is the bottom. Right? The green part, very easy, it's called occipital lobe, and that's vision. There's a lot of vision. So anything that comes through your eyes is processed in the green part. The orange part is called the temporal lobe, and it does auditory processing and language processing. All right? The purple part is an interesting part called the parietal lobe. It does a lot of the mapping, the multimodal mapping. So during the early stages of reading development, it's very involved in mapping the sound of language onto the written counterparts. And we have the frontal lobe, which I always call the CEO of the brain, because it does exactly what a CEO does in a company. It decides what's important and what's not. It helps us inhibit things. Oh, I really want to eat that donut. No, I shouldn't. So that's all what's right there in your frontal lobe. This one here is a video, and it shows an adult reading a couple of words. And it looks a little bit funny, the brain, but it's basically just the brain that we blew up with the computer. So you can see all the different valleys and mountains. The valleys are called sulky, and the mountains are called gyri. Okay? And so I'm playing this, and you will see over the 700 milliseconds here what is happening in the brain if someone reads a couple of words. Okay, where is that not working? All right, I'll play it one more time for you. Think about what you just learned the slide before, the different brain areas. Occipital in the back, which does vision, auditory language in the temporal lobe, primarily on the left side of the brain. We have the mapping in the parietal lobe here, and we have the CEO of the brain that integrates everything. So I'll pray it one more time, and you tell me what you think. All right. Okay, I think you get the point here. So reading happens first in the back, right? And then it moves in the front. And I think a lot of people are always surprised how many different brain areas are actually working together. And I think you should keep that in mind when you teach to read, because it's an incredible work for the brain to coordinate all these brain regions to actually facilitate reading. And we ask kids to do this in just 100, 200, 300 days in kindergarten. Okay, so to summarize, reading primarily, it's not the only brain regions, but primarily is facilitated through four key regions on the left side of your brain. So the fusiform gyrus here is often called the letterbox or the visual word form area. It does recognize letters and it does recognize words. Then we have the temporal lobe here, very involved in listening comprehension, language in general. And then we have this mapper that maps the sounds of language onto the written counterparts, and the CEO here. The brain just doesn't just have cortical areas or these areas that that are important for reading. They need to talk to each other, and what they do is they talk to each other through highways. Okay, we call them white matter tracts, but I call them highways for today. So these are like highways that facilitate information flow from one brain area to the other brain areas. It's a very long axons, in fact. And we have very important highways in the brain. So for instance, here in red, it's a highway that connects the back of the brain of the reading network with the front of the reading network. So the recognizing letters, the mapping of the sounds to the letters with the CEO. The development of basic reading skills is one of the primary goals of elementary education. But this is, I think there's newer numbers now, but in the same ballpark. 66% of US fourth graders are not reading at grade level, and among students from low socioeconomic backgrounds, 80% are reading below grade level. If you're reading below grade level in first grade, 70% of these kids are still reading below grade level in ninth grade. All right? If you're a typical reader, you improve your vocabulary dramatically from kindergarten to fifth grade. Okay, so this is your size of vocabulary. These are the two grades. And about 250 words per week are added to your what we call the lexicon. What are the literacy experiences for poor readers? So, Torgerson, who is a very famous reading researcher, estimated that students at the 90th percentile may read as many words in 2 days as a child at the 10th percentile reads in an entire year outside of school. Right? So you see what a big impact this has if you don't catch it early and you wait and wait, because there's a lot of words that are not entered into the lexicon. So what are the factors contributing to atypical reading development? So there's just not one factor. It's actually genetics, the brain, perception and cognition, and environment. And these all together lead to typical or atypical reading development. So people are often very confused about reading disability, dyslexia, what is the difference. And I think it's still a debate in the field. But for now and for today and for my work, I see it like this. So reading disability is the broader umbrella. And then we have dyslexia as one part, especially the, and we'll get to this, kids who have a genetic predisposition to have very specific differences in their brain development. And then you have a reading disability as a result of environmental circumstances. Right? That doesn't mean that they don't need the same instruction or maybe a little bit more targeted depending on their skills, and Melissa will get to this, but I wanted to make this important distinction because it will come up later again. So what are some of the environmental factors of reading development? It has been estimated that about 50% of children with language weaknesses or impairments will have problems with reading. Children with unresolved language weaknesses are at a higher risk for reading abilities if those languages weaknesses are not addressed in the early grades, especially kids with ethnic or language minority children, immigrants, and children from low SDS families are at a higher risk. And so there's been some interesting work by Anne Fernald from Stanford showing that by 18 months already, low-income children are already several months behind in their oral language development. So what is developmental dyslexia? And this is the definition of the International Dyslexia Association. So the numbers go back and forth, but it's about, the new numbers are about 3 to 12% of children who have dyslexia. It's a specific learning disability with a neurobiological origin characterized by difficulties with accurate and fluent word recognition, poor spelling, and poor decoding abilities. And this one cannot be explained by poor vision or hearing, lack of motivation, or if you never entered a school because you're living in rural Africa, then and that's the reason you can't read, that would not be called dyslexia. There are really strong psychological and clinical implications of dyslexia that long start before kids get a diagnosis. Just a few examples. So children with reading disabilities are often perceived by others as being lazy or those who don't try enough. You often see decreased self-esteem as a result, shame, failure, helplessness, depression, possible antisocial behavior. And if these kids are not remediated, then they're less likely to enter a complete high school, enter programs of higher education, and they have an increased probability to enter the juvenile justice system. So how about genetics? There are lots of studies now that have shown that if you have an older sibling with dyslexia or a parent, you have about a 50% chance. Okay? So this is your first screener alarm here, right there. Right? So if your school district is super poor or you run against a lot of closed doors, you can implement a screener. At least ask the question, if they allow you, is there a history of a reading disability in the family? Because if there are, there's a 50% chance that the child also will struggle. If there's two parents, it goes up to 75%. All right? There will never be one dyslexia gene. So the genes that people have identified so far are called dyslexia susceptibility genes because they seem to somewhat contribute, but they're not directly causal. And these are all implemented in neural brain, in early brain development in utero. So the way this goes is that these genes work differently, which then leads to differences in how the brain puts itself together, which then may not show up right away in some skills after birth, but once the child has to form a reading network, then when these atypically formed network in utero become a problem. So these are primarily seen in the posterior part, so the back part of the reading network. So people think that there's the atypical brain development here, which then leads to problems with phonological awareness, problems with mapping the sounds of language onto the written counterpart, because that's exactly these two areas here, which then leads to impaired reading. And that's actually what a lot of studies have shown. So you can look at the number of neurons, so basically the hardware, but you can also look at the function. So what we do is we measure this with fMRI, which actually looks at when the neurons consume oxygen, when the neurons have to do work, they're processing, then they have to consume oxygen. And so you can measure this oxygen consumption, and that gives you these pretty pictures. So what we can show is that individuals with dyslexia, it doesn't matter if you look at the hardware or the brain function, show a deficit in these brain regions, including the visual world form area, these mapper that helps mapping the sounds onto the written counterparts, as well as the CO. Also, we see differences in the highways. So the way we can measure this is we can determine how strong the highway is. And what people have shown is that there's, we call it less integrity. What this means is it could be that the highway, instead of four lanes, is only two lanes. Or it could be it's more bumpy, so you can't drive as fast because of the myelination is different. Or it has a lot of crossing fibers where there shouldn't be any, which is almost like traffic lights on your highway. All right, so that makes information flow slow down. What people also have shown is that these deficits in the back of the reading network are not delayed maturation. What they did here for Mika Haft and John Gabrielli here at MIT is they compared first 9-year-old kids with dyslexia to 9-year-old kids without dyslexia. And they saw the same problem in the back part of the reading network. Then they thought, how about we compare the 9-year-olds with dyslexia to 6-year-olds who do not have dyslexia, but they're reading on the same level, right? So if it's delayed maturation, then maybe these 9-year-olds look like the 6-year-olds, and they will eventually catch up. But what they could show is that's not the case. The 9-year-olds did not, the same deficit in the back part of the reading network on the left side was seen for the 9-year-olds when compared to the 9-year-olds without dyslexia and when compared to the 6-year-olds who were actually reading on the same level. So it's a fundamental difference. It's not delayed maturation of the brain, because that's sometimes an argument that I hear. All right, so also, these differences I just explained to you are independent of IQ, which I think is very important, right? There is no evidence showing that these hypoactivations or lower oxygen consumption or the changes in the highways is there if you have dyslexia with high IQ and is there if you have dyslexia with low IQ. It's the same difference, all right? Okay, so let's get to the dyslexia paradox. So right now, in a lot of our school districts, we have what we call a failure model or the way to fail approach. So you have to fail over a significant amount of time before you get really intensive access to access to intensive resources. The sad part is that the research in the last couple of years have shown that the window for the most effective intervention is in kindergarten and first grade. All right? And so a lot of people ask me, like, why is that? And so research has shown that there's heightened plasticity. It means the brain can change much quicker. It's more dynamic the younger the brain is, especially for language. And so I give you an example. If I would all now take you and move you to, let's say, Italy. Let's assume no one here speaks Italian. So if I move you now, it will be really hard for you to learn Italian like a native, sound like a native, speak without an accent, learn all the grammar in a relatively short period of time. If I move a 4-year-old to Italy, within like 2 or 3 years, most likely, they will have no accent and will have a much better language skills than do, because the brain is much more plastic for language the younger it is. So this is just, you will get the slide, an overview of these differences in effect size between intervening at the later grades compared to intervening at the earlier grades. Okay, so for instance, when at-risk beginning readers receive intensive instruction, 56 to 92 of at-risk children across 6 studies, so that's a meta-analysis, meaning several studies were looked at the same time, reached the range of average reading ability. So what are earlier behavioral predictors of dyslexia? So we'll get into the screening part, and I'll tell you exactly what we think, what components need to go into the screener, but let's look at the research first. So there has been many excellent longitudinal studies, meaning you follow these kids over several years. There are big studies done in Finland. There were some done in the Netherlands, in the UK. And what they show that phonological awareness, short-term memory, rapid naming or rapid amortized naming, expressive and often also receptive vocabulary, through the word repetition, huh? That should go together with the short-term memory and letter naming, are really good early predictors of reading outcome. So for instance, there is a study from Finland that showed that familial risk, remember, 50% of kids who have an older sibling or parent will develop a reading disability. Letter sound knowledge, phonological awareness, and rapid automatized naming at 3.5 years. So that's, you know, preschool, predicted later outcome, especially if the kids got a diagnosis of dyslexia or not. What people often forget is the home literacy environment. So it also explains a significant amount of variance. So it's important to keep this in mind to get the whole picture of what are the different factors attributing or leading to atypical and typical reading development. So the way we measure this is ask, how early did you start reading to your child? How often do you read to your child? How often do you go to the library? How often does your child see you read and enjoy reading? Things like this. So to get an idea, what is the home literacy environment? And so we have one tricky thing where we ask parents, we give them a long list of children's books titles, and they have to indicate which ones are real and which ones are fake. And so there you can really measure if they just have this beautiful library at home and no one really reads to the child, or whether they actually read to the child, because if you read the same book 100 times, you will remember the title. I have 3 kids myself, so I know. All right, so let's look at the brain. So we did a study called the Boston Longitudinal Dyslexia Study, and that was started in 2008, and we're still following some of these kids. And we looked at kids who have a familial risk of dyslexia positive, familial risk of dyslexia negative, and then the difference. And what these kids did is they did a phonological awareness task inside an MRI machine. And we looked at which areas in the brain were consuming oxygen, so basically were working really hard. And what we could show is that already, this is in preschoolers, before they ever stepped into the first day of kindergarten, we see this dysfunction here in the posterior and the back part of the reading network. Okay, so that was an important study because it showed us these problems are there before they come to kindergarten. It's not that failing on a daily basis over 3 years leads to this. No, they're stepping with their little backpack into their first day of kindergarten with the less optimal brain to learn to read. Okay? So there's no reason to wait whether they mature or to wait 3 years whether some miracle happens. You would not wait, you know, if someone has a knee injury, you're not waiting 3 years and let them fail to walk up the stairs before you get them help. We saw this also for the number of neurons. So we're counting the number of neurons, more or less, and saw this in the left hemisphere. This time we took the right away, and you see the left hemisphere. The more neurons you had in these typical reading networks, the better were your pre-reading skills. This is also a study by a different group. And if you just look at this left column here, you see kids who are typical children at the start of kindergarten, and then typical children after 3 months of kindergarten. So you see they're starting to form a reading network in response to teaching. But the kids at risk were doing, there was some changes, but that was outside of the traditional reading network. Okay, so they're not forming, they're not having the same reading development in the brain than their typical developing peers. What we could also show in one study called the Reed study with MIT is that your highway, I told you there's a highway that connects the back part of the radio network with the front is the bigger this highway is, the stronger. Think about the lanes and the bumpiness and the traffic lights, the better your phonological awareness was. So this is the blending word raw test from the C-top. We could also show that this is, again, this arcuate fasciculus, this highway, that it's relatively stable over time. So we see differences in pre-readers and beginning readers and fluent readers, right? So let's get a little bit more into the screening part. So we did the READ study with John Gabrielli at MIT. And what we did is we basically contacted school districts and said, hi, we are Boston Children's Hospital, Harvard Medical School, MIT, and we come for free in your school district. And we screen everyone for free. Within 2 weeks, we give you feedback on the screener. We give you professional development, how to address things in the classroom. We help you interpret the screener. We'll talk to teachers. We'll talk to parents, and we do brain awareness days. And we'll do this 3 years in a row. Do you want to sign up? So we thought hundreds of school districts will say, me, can we sign up me for free? Oh my gosh, this is so great. No, actually, we had a lot of school districts. I'm not naming any names, but they're very close to where we are located. Not right now, but where I usually work. That said, we don't want to see you anywhere close to us. And we said, why? And they said, well, because if MIT and Harvard identifies children at risk in kindergarten, then we don't have resources for that. We don't want to shift resources. And, you know, they will fail in third grade, and then we can pick them up because it's all set up. We don't, you know, the parents will go crazy if you tell them they're at risk, and then we don't have anything implemented. No, we don't want to even know. So that was very sad, and it did not just happen once. It happened over and over and over. But we came up, we finally had 21 schools, and they're all over, and some of them had 80% reduced free lunch, some of them had 0% reduced free lunch, so about 49% minority. We had private schools, public schools, archdiocese schools, urban, suburban, charter, everything included. What we then did is we screened them, and here you see data from about 1,200. We screened over 1,500. And we asked the computer, can you tell us, so we screened them with, this is not a recommended screening battery just yet, but I'm just telling you what we did. We screened them with IQ, phonological awareness, working memory, rapid automatized naming, and letter sound knowledge. And then we followed them over several years. And so then we asked the computer program, can you give us groups of kids that are homogeneous, they're performing the same within each group, but then the groups, we want them to be very separate. And the computer gave us 6 distinct cognitive profiles of early reading. So here you have the number 0, and it shows kids in black who are average. And these are kids in this group who are average in IQ, super average on all of these measures. Then we have kids who are really much, much better than their peers on average in all of these measures, not surprisingly. What's surprisingly is these risk profiles. So look at this blue group here. These are kids that have average IQ, average phonological awareness, average working memory, average letter sound knowledge, but really low rapid automatized naming. Okay? And actually, if we look, these kids had reading fluency issues later. They were fine with decoding, but they had problems with reading fluency later. And then we had other kids who really were struggling with reading, were primarily the ones that had low phonological awareness and working memory. Okay, we also, just in the last piece of information for the background, have a study in infants where we can track this highway in infants, and you will not believe it, but this highway is already different in 6-month-olds if they have a familiar risk versus if they don't. Okay, so and it also correlates with, we follow them with how they do 4 or 5 years later. So you can see that similar networks are, similar parts of this highway as impaired in infants and pre-readers and beginning readers and fluent readers. So how do we solve the dyslexia paradox? So we want to move from a failure model to more of a support model. So we want to screen early for dyslexia risk, reading disability risk, and accurately identify children and then support them with evidence-based early intervention. All right? And so this, if everything goes smooth, should then lead to lower rates of dyslexia or reading disability diagnosis and improve reading outcome in children with dyslexia and reading disability. So some people have already done this. So there's a dear colleague, Hugh Katz, at the Florida State University and Reading Institute. What they did is they had this the screening where they used letter naming fluency from the Dibbles, the initial sound fluency from the Dibbles, the sound matching from the C top, a couple others. You can see this here. Then they used the two Dibbles and one C top for progress monitoring, and then they looked for reading outcome. And then they also looked at kids who had tier 2 intervention for 26 years. And so they could show that this screening battery accurately identified good and poor readers at the end of first grade. Okay, so that's the main message here. So this was a really good screening battery that very accurately predicted at the end of first grade, so this was the beginning of kindergarten, who will struggle later and who will not. So there's been a lot of discussion, as you know, about the response to intervention, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. There's been a study 2 years ago that basically showed that first graders who received reading interventions actually did worse than their identical peers who did not get the more targeted assistance. So they looked at kids who, overall, this is over 20,000 students. And they especially looked at kids who just made the cut and got the tier 2 versus kids who did not make the cut and stayed in tier 1. And so there's been many papers written on why that is. And people said, yes, a lot of problems are implementation and resources, and it's a very complicated system that's maybe too bulky for the school system, but we are not getting into detail. What I want to take out of this is that people said also inaccurate screenings, inaccurate interventions, not targeted to the deficit, and the implementation are definitely some of the reasons. So I brought you this, and you will have that in your handout. But these are all the screeners I could find in the last couple of months that are actually starting in kindergarten or pre-kindergarten. So I need your help, because we want to publish this and we want to widely distribute this, because it tells you what the different assessment types are, whether it's digital, who publishes this, whether it has been validated, how long it takes, et cetera. So we think it's a great resource. But if you use a screener in your schools, or you heard of a screener, or you saw someone using a screener that's not on the list, please email me, okay? Because I want to add this. I don't think this is final. So this has 28 or 29. But I really need your help, because we want to get them all on the list so that we give people a good overview of this. So why and when should we screen? So just a summary of what I told you in the last 30 minutes. Dyslexia is a neurobiological disorder. Brain alterations in dyslexia can be seen as early as infancy. Brain plasticity decreases through childhood. Children at risk can be reliably identified. Psychological and clinical implications can be prevented and minimized if you start early. And a screening tool will benefit all children, not just the ones who develop dyslexia. So how come? All right, so here is a recommended screening battery. And I have at the end an overview as well. So it should contain a phonological awareness measure. And what I have to say is, and we tested lots of kids in my lab, is this really depends on the age, right? So we tried to do like a first sound matching or a blending or elision task in very young kids, like 4-year-olds or even below 4. They don't get it. So for these kids, I would, for instance, recommend a rhyming task. So they usually can rhyme. They don't get the concept yet, which doesn't mean, I think, necessarily that they have a phonological awareness problem. I think if they can rhyme at age 3, 4, I would say they're fine. But you have to be really thinking developmentally, what is my age group of the kids I'm trying to screen? A verbal phonological short-term memory measure. So this is like a non-word repetition, right? A rapid automatized naming measure, a letter sound knowledge measure. Again, if the children are, let's say, coming from low SES backgrounds, they often never got instructed to what sound does the letter make, right? So if you get them in kindergarten and you screen the first day of kindergarten, you will just screen for SES and not for for dyslexia. Because for these kids, you may wait till they got some instruction and letter sound knowledge and see how fast they catch up. And then compare them to their peers and not necessarily to the standardized test. A vocabulary measure and a measure of oral comprehension. The reason I put group them is this will really tell you whether the child has a problem with will have a problem with decoding, with mapping the sounds onto the onto the written counterparts, the letters, or whether the kids will have problems with reading comprehension, maybe, or reading fluency because they have really low vocabularies, maybe because they're coming from a certain environment where they're speaking dialect or there is just less words in the household. The same with listening comprehension, right? So it doesn't mean, and I know Melissa will get into this, that these kids don't need help. But it may mean that these kids need very different help. So if you are fine with your phonological awareness, but your vocabulary and listening comprehension is really low, you may be able to learn to decode, but then you will struggle once the text gets longer and half of the vocabulary you don't know, or the sentence has a comma and you never, you know, you're not used to hearing sentences that have maybe a garden path or have like a different structure, okay? So I think that's really important to include this. Lots of schools just screen for letter sound knowledge or phonological awareness, but then these kids who will struggle because of their oral language will fall through the cracks. The word ID measure, this is really depending on the age, definitely not in K and in preschool, I wouldn't say, not at the beginning. And so this also can be timed or untimed, but it will primarily focus on K for now. And then family history. So warning, none of it will matter if the intervention does not target the deficit with evidence-based instruction specific to the deficit identified, right? That's where Melissa's part will come in. You can screen the whole world, and you will probably be totally fine. Wow, we screened all these kids. If there's nothing, if there's no response to screening, why would you screen in the first place? Makes no sense, right? All right, so I wrote this last year or this year for the International Dyslexia Association as a guide. We recommend 8 key characteristics when determining optimal screening battery. The screener should be short. It's not a diagnostic tool. You're not, you know, doing a whole battery. It has to be short. It has to be comprehensive, meaning it should have these components that we just discussed. It can be resourceful. What I mean here is you don't have to buy a fancy screener from the list I just showed you. You could go and see what kind of tests are available that are usually used in third grade and see whether they are normed for kindergartners. And maybe these kids can be used and recycled or shifted into the kindergarten or preschool classroom. It has to be early. So I think preschool, early kindergarten, we should not wait longer. ESL dialect inclusion. I have some slides after in three or four slides where we talk specifically about ESL and dialect. Neurobiology genetics, what I mean here is include familiar risk. Okay, so we were discussing whether this may be an HIPAA issue, but you need to talk and see whether you're allowed to ask this. But if you are, or you could do this in a parent-teacher conference, is like if the, you know, ask, was there anyone in your family who you had problems learning to read growing up? And then ask more questions. If they say yes, try to figure out why. Was it because they lived in rural Mexico and there was no school, which may be different, you know, than if someone said, yeah, I was in this very expensive prep school, but they tried for a really long time and I couldn't learn to read, but somehow I managed and now I'm an engineer at MIT and I'm fine, right? So I think you want to really learn what is the familiar risk. Is there a genetic component? Is there an environmental component that can inform this? Evidence-based response to screening, we went over this. You don't have to screen if there's nothing in place. Developmentally appropriate, what I mean here is you don't want to do reading passage comprehension in kindergarten. Right? So that's not developmentally appropriate. So think, who are the kids in front of me? Okay, there are four. Let's say I have K-1 junior kindergarten. They all can't do elision. They must all be dyslexic. No, think about it. How can I measure phonological awareness differently, maybe through rhyming? What's also really important are the next two slides. If you have a screener in place that you develop yourself or someone gave to you or you just like make up something, it's really important to think about validity and reliability. So validity is, does the test I have in front of me assess what it's supposed to measure, right? So that if you have a test for phonological awareness, does it actually measure phonological awareness? Or did someone just give me something and, you know, I'll just use this? Do all of the items I have represent the domain? Do they all measure phonological awareness or are they all over the place, which is not good as well? Are the test scores related to the future? So has anyone looked at whether this test actually predicts whether someone will be fine or not? And does knowledge of the test result lead to changes in the child's life? So does it enable educators to accurately prescribe an effective treatment, right, or an intervention? Also, determining an appropriate cutoff point is crucial, right? So in that study I showed you where they looked at the RTI in the 20,000 students, one big critique was that these people implemented a cutoff of 41%. So everyone who was lower than 41% got tier two. So you have to think, we usually think that kids who will struggle significantly are probably the lower 30, lower 25th percentile. That doesn't mean that the others should be ignored, right? But these are the kids that need the most help. Reliability. If you have two people administering the test in two different classrooms, do you get, if the test is administered by two different people to the same child, do you get the same result? Or is it really depending on the person administering it? If you do it twice in the same child, do you get the same result? So these are all questions you need to ask yourself if you have a handmade tool, right? And think like, do I feel comfortable with this? Or do I try to push that a standardized screener should be used? Okay, so reliability and validity are very critical for success. All right, the last couple minutes before I finish is screening bilingual or ELL children. So there are at least two big myths that ELL children have problems with learning to read because of the inadequate oral language proficiency, cultural differences in tests, they just don't know how to test, instructional approaches, or confusing their two languages. And in order to screen, you should wait until language proficiency is developed and assess the students in their home language. All right, so there's actually a really great researcher, Esther Giever, who actually showed that her recommendations I have here. So first of all, think that in ELL children, you should have the same prevalence of, so if you have in your school about 15% of kids who really struggle with reading, you should expect the same number in the ELL children, right? So if their language would be proficient. So just to, the underlying prevalence of a reading disability is the same in kids who have one language versus two languages. What she also recommends is tracking the developmental patterns. So do they get better over time? So you may want to assess them more frequently, or is it that they just can't do the phonological awareness over several time points, and then you should be alarmed. Like monolinguals, this should say ELL. ELL children have problems with key predictor skills, okay? But she recommends that these key predictor skills should be used in English if they are educated in the English system and don't necessarily have to be done in their home language. And then she also says don't delay assessment, and most importantly, compare these children to their reference group and not the other kids. Okay, so if you have 15 ELL children and 12 of them really make progress in their language and their reading and their phonological awareness when you repeatedly progress monitor them, but there's three who just don't, like this should be the warning. Compare them to the others, don't compare them to the English monolinguals. All right, so where should we screen? In schools, but also we are developing a screener that we hope maybe everyone should screen at their 4 and 5 year well visit when they go to their pediatrician. Maybe it's a link you get at home and you can do it on a tablet or in a waiting area, like your lead test. We give you vaccines, we test for lead, we screen for reading disability. Children homes, and so that's a screener we are developing right now that's on the tablet and hopefully could be used very self-administered in preschools, pre-kindergarten info sessions, summer camps, children's museum, speech and language therapy, occupational therapy sessions. So just to show you, we are working on the screener. It's not going to be done for probably another 9 months, a year. Then it needs to be normed. We are working on the validation right now. But if you're interested or your school district to be part of this, email me because we are looking for school districts that would be interested in doing this. So what this will do is it will integrate existing predictive assessments into a mobile platform. And then we will screen, and then it will also have a response to screening where there's some what to do next with this kind of child, some recommendations. So we think it needs these two components. But basically, it's for 4 and 5 year olds primarily. It's the kid picks a friend, and then they walk to the city, to a lake, to let their sailboat run, and they meet these adults. And these adults say, hey, do you want an ice cream? Let's play a game first. And then the friend plays like a phonological awareness game with the polar bear first. Then they turn to you and say, do you want to play too? And then the child is encouraged to play and they get ice cream. And so it's a very playful way of assessing dyslexia risk. And then also we have a big section with videos, and we're partnering up with understood.org in the response to interventions, to screening section. All right, so this was it for the overview about screening. We'll have a Q&A if you have any questions. Again, these are the components: phonological awareness, phonological short-term memory, rapid automatized naming, letter sound knowledge, vocabulary, oral comprehension, especially here. This can tell you whether the kids struggle because they have problems with phonological awareness or rapid automatized naming. So are the processes in place? And this will tell you whether the language is in place. Okay, so you need both components, and there will be kids who are only at risk here, and they need very different things later than the kids who are only at risk here, right? And then familiar risk, don't underestimate this as an important source. Thank you.
Thank Dr. Gaab again for such a thoughtful presentation. As she was speaking, it really occurred to me about just the depth and complexity of work that's been done in this field and the money that's been poured into it and the resources and the data that we now have. We have mountains and mountains of data, and she just really gave us a very bird's eye view of that information. But this data gets published in academic journals, and academic journals are read by academics. And it's hard to get it into the hands of educators. So we realize not everyone can be here at this talk listening to Dr. Gaab explain it, and we wanted to make kind of a simplified version of this information that can be widely shared. So we put together this little video. It's going to be a summary, a recapitulation of what Dr. Gaab has said. And this is something that you can share with colleagues, with friends, with educators, if you are so inclined.
The Department of Child Study at Tufts University presents Preventing Reading Impairments, Screening Made Easy for Educators. You are a teacher, a reading specialist, or an administrator, and you became an educator because you care about kids. You are an important person in children's lives, and you work incredibly hard to make sure that you are maximizing their learning. Here's some information that's going to make your job a little bit easier. It's about reading. Reading is perhaps the most fundamental skill children will develop because it's the critical tool for learning all other content. Every year, there are students who will struggle with learning to read, and up to 10% of those students will be diagnosed with dyslexia. In the past, educators often felt unprepared to identify and support students who struggled with reading. But in the last 25 years, mountains of evidence from educational research have identified 4 pre-reading skills that can reliably indicate who is at risk. The first skill is called phonological awareness. It refers to a student's ability to break apart, rearrange, and combine the sounds and words during listening activities. The second skill is called sound-symbol correspondence. It refers to students' familiarity with letters and their corresponding sounds. The third skill is called naming speed. It requires children to quickly retrieve the names of objects, colors, or letters. This skill is not as widely known, but it serves as the foundation for their ability to retrieve words during reading. And finally, it is important to assess a child's oral language ability with measures of vocabulary or listening comprehension skills. These early literacy skills lay the groundwork for later literacy skills. For example, children who struggle with phonological processing and sound symbol correspondence are very likely to have trouble with decoding, while naming speed and oral language ability predicts fluency and comprehension. Starting in kindergarten, educators can use standardized measures to determine who is at risk. The earlier we can identify kids, the better their chances at remediation. When 6 to 8-year-olds are given 100 hours of intervention, it brings the majority of them into the average range, but the same dosage is not sufficient to help 9 to 12-year-olds achieve fluency benchmarks. Why aren't interventions as effective with older students? Well, although typical and struggling readers start out at similar levels, the gap grows substantially in a short period of time. This can be explained by a phenomenon called the Matthew effect. According to the Matthew effect, children who have fully developed reading skills read more material, and that helps their reading skills develop further. In fact, really good readers read more outside of school in 3 days than a poor reader will read in an entire year. So now you know, there is no need to wait. You can screen for reading difficulties before children start kindergarten, early intervention is better, and the four predictive measures are phonological processing, sound symbol correspondence, naming speed, and oral language ability.
Okay, so we will make this little video available on our website. We'll send a link to a Dropbox account so it can be watched wherever by whomever. All right, so we're going to switch gears a little bit, and I am now going to be talking about intervention, where I left off. Okay, we were talking about. All right, so let's talk about intervention. Here it is. Okay. As Nadine mentioned, you know, the first step is screening, but screening is only an initial foray into this whole idea of being able to identify a child's weakness and being able to target intervention and then progress monitor how they're developing their skills. This is a part, again, as we're talking about a system, this is a part of a larger system or framework of assessment. Marianne Wolf, who is my boss and the faculty member here at Tufts, says it's never the fault of the child, but rather the responsibility of those who teach to find methods that work for the child. And finding those methods are so critical. And that's one of the reasons that a screening tool or an assessment tool that's looking at various sub-lexical pieces of reading ability is essential. And I'll talk about what that word sublexical means, especially for kindergartners and first graders who may not have developed word reading skills yet. So we're going to be talking about tier two intervention. So just to make sure everyone's on the same page, we've all heard of the kind of the RTI model. Tier one support is what's being delivered in the whole classroom. This is thought to be sufficient for about 80% of students. Tier two is going to be the extra support that's added for the 15% of students who are not making sufficient progress with the classroom instruction. So this can be delivered in a variety of different ways. It can be delivered by a specialist, by the classroom teacher, by the coach. And then finally, there's the tier three group. This should be about 5%, a very small percentage of students who require a substantially different type of instruction that it has to be delivered with an individual with specialized training. So if we think about the assessment framework and that screening piece that Nadine was talking about, that's going to be the first step, screening and an initial benchmark. After the screening, you're going to develop your tiers, right? Who's going to be in tier one? Who's going to be my small group instruction in tier two? And who is in tier three, either with a history or with enough concern that you're referring them for eligibility testing? You're then progress monitoring them. And based on the progress monitoring results, you may be referring a group of your tier two students for eligibility testing. This is a pretty familiar protocol for most school districts. Then you have your second benchmark assessment. Again, you have your tiers. You might be regrouping. Hopefully, some of the students in tier two have now moved down to tier one, but there might be some students who pop up who need tier two instruction. Your progress monitoring again, eligibility testing, and then your final benchmark. So these are all pieces that are coming together and influencing each other. Now, As Nadine mentioned, at each grade level, we have different skills that are developmentally appropriate. So in the beginning of kindergarten, what's really appropriate are these sublexical skills. So these are skills that are below the word level. Lexical means word. So these are the foundational skills. This is what is laying the architecture for later word reading ability. Phonological processing, sound symbol correspondence, rapid naming, and oral language. Midway through kindergarten, non-word reading is typically a component of benchmark measures. So students start reading words about halfway through the year. In first grade, it looks different. So again, phonological processing is still really important in first grade, as is sound symbol correspondence, rapid naming, and oral language. Those are all the sublexical measures. You have the non-word reading again, but now you're beginning to look at connected text fluency. How does the child manage sentences? How do they manage passages? How are all of these skills now building on each other so that it starts to look like what we think of as being a literate student? And then finally, in second grade, some of the earlier assessments drop away because they are not as predictive as screening tools. That doesn't mean that you wouldn't use them in a diagnostic battery, but for a quick screening tool, what you'd want to still look at are rapid naming, and we'll talk a bit about rapid naming. That tends to be a less familiar area of knowledge. Rapid naming in oral language, non-word reading, and again, oral reading fluency and comprehension. We're going to be focusing in on K through 2, and we're going to be talking about why these particular skills are important, what teachers should know about instruction in phonological processing, in rapid naming, and in oral language, because these tend to be lesser known areas than something like phonics. I'm not going to address phonics too much today in my talk. One of the panelists is going to talk about teaching routines for phonics, but I would say, by and large, when we go into school districts, phonics is an area that people have covered, that they have knowledge about teaching routines and phonics and the essential skills. It's these areas that tend to be less supported in instruction. So for each of these different areas, I'm going to talk about the importance of the instruction and then give you an example of a tier two teaching routine. Now, there are lots of talented educators in this audience, and you probably have your own teaching routines, and I would love it, actually, if you would share them with me, too, because crowdsourcing. but these are just examples of teaching routines that we've seen work either in research or in our own practice. So I'm going to start with phonological processing. So believe it or not, phonological processing research has been around for the last 50 years, 57 years. It started in the 60s in Haskins Laboratory, and researchers realized that individual sounds or individual phonemes are difficult to perceive because when we're speaking, they're co-articulated. That means they all kind of blend together. We don't speak with segmenting each sound in a word. We blend them all together. What the researchers at Haskins found was that when you draw students' conscious attention to these individual speech sounds, it improves their reading. When they're aware of how to segment the sounds in words before they ever learn the symbols, they're at a greater advantage of then matching up letters and sounds. They have the sound piece down and they can just map on the letters. It's an essential skill that most children do not come into kindergarten thinking about. If you ask a child how many sounds are in the word blast, what will they say? One. They'll say one because they don't know that there are all of these different sounds. That's a level of unfolding that needs to be taught to most children. So what's the difference between phonological awareness and phonics? So phonological awareness is an auditory skill. It's sometimes people say it's something that can be done in the dark. A child who acquires phonological awareness develops the ability to discriminate, manipulate, and remember the speech sounds. And it follows a progression. It goes from sentence level, telling, you know, being able to identify how many words are in a sentence, to the word level, to the syllable level. When they can manipulate individual sounds in words, that's when they've reached phonemic awareness, because phonemic awareness refers to phonemes, the individual speech sounds. Phonics is a visual skill. So what phonics is doing, and this is a graphic that I got from Reading Rocket, so this is pretty widely available. When children acquire phonics, they are looking at letters and they're associating them with the corresponding sounds. So they start with individual letters, they learn their sound symbol correspondence, then they move progressively towards whole words. Phonics is linking the sound and the letter, and phonics instruction will go more quickly when the child has automatized their phonemic awareness knowledge because they've done half the job. So what do kindergarten and first grade teachers need to know about phonological or phonemic awareness, especially for tier two? Now, phonemic awareness instruction should certainly be happening in tier one, definitely in kindergarten and in first grade. But there are going to be students who struggle with this area. It's one of the most common areas of weakness in early reading development because we're not born learning to read. We're not born thinking about the individual sounds. It's something that we have to develop. So the key elements that teachers need to know for instruction are, first of all, how skills progress. Oftentimes, we think of phonemic awareness and we think of rhyming, which Nadine identified as one of the big assessments of phonemic awareness. But phonemic awareness starts way before rhyming. Rhyming is actually kind of a mid-level skill for phonemic awareness. So we want to look at the skill progression, but you're always moving from large units to small units of sound. You want to also think about sounds. There is a way to exploit our articulation abilities to help children produce and isolate sounds in a more efficient way. So we'll talk about that, moving, for example, from hold to stop sounds using the vowel circle. And also you want to think about what would a teaching routine look like. So A, it needs to be explicit. But B, it also needs to have that gradual release component where the teacher's modeling, then the teacher and student are doing together, and then the student has the opportunity to practice individually. And for children who have weaknesses in phonological awareness and rapid naming, who are coming up on the screening, and we'll talk more about rapid naming in a minute, but who are coming up on the screening in those two areas, their weaknesses in rapid naming are going to prevent them from developing phonological awareness to a level of automaticity. There's a bottleneck for them in retrieving all of these skills very quickly. And so you always want to think about giving them opportunities to overlearn these tasks. You're previewing, you're reviewing, you're constantly cycling back, you're feeding in moments throughout the day. Maybe you have a 30-minute segment, but it's broken up into a 15-minute in the morning and 15-minute in the afternoon, so that you can keep coming back to these skills and giving them opportunities for automaticity. Okay, so let's just talk for a minute about the progression of phonemic awareness. I got this from a website called Tuneful Teaching, and it's an amazingly comprehensive graphic of how phonological awareness progresses to phonemic awareness. Just a couple things I want to point out to you. It starts with sentences and sounds. It moves to words, like being able to say cowboy without saying cow, say popcorn without saying pop. It goes to breaking apart individual words into their onset and rhyme. So in cow, k is the onset, and ow is the rhyme pattern. So it's systematically moving into smaller and smaller units. And then finally, it's the ability to say cow, now change cow to mow, and asking children to somehow indicate to you whether they're moving tokens or pointing to the place where a word might be, what would move. Now, it's not until the very last stage of phonemic awareness that you would introduce letters, because you don't want this to be a symbol instruction. You want it to be a sound instruction. You're using lots of visual supports. You have a picture of a cow. You have a picture of a cowboy. Maybe you're breaking the cowboy in half so that they see how you're breaking a word like cowboy into its two syllables. But you're not bringing in symbols yet as part of this instruction until the very end. You're teaching kids to be sound analysts. They're all of a sudden, children are thinking about words. They're thinking about sounds at this metalinguistic level. They're noticing all of these different components that they were not aware of before. So for example, at the sentence level, we want to know how many words are in a sentence. At the single word level, we want to know how many syllables are in a word. We want children to know all of this and to be able to indicate it to us. At the individual syllable level, we want children to break up words into onset rhyme all the way down to the individual consonant and vowel sounds. Now, sound awareness is a wonderful source of technical knowledge that kindergarten and first grade teachers should be made available to all kindergarten and all first grade teachers, not just specialists. Because the way in which we introduce sounds can really maximize instruction. So for example, when you're teaching children how to segment a word like fig, you want to start with what's called a hold sound. So fig, everyone say fig. That's easy for you to hold, to stretch out so they can hear the sounds. Now try the same thing with the word big. Stretch out the word big. Big. It's harder, right? Because big is what's called a stop sound. It has to do with how we articulate these sounds, whether we're using a puff of air, all of the different articulatory practices, and your speech and language pathologists in your schools can help you better understand this. But there are ways in which, if you progress following these different recommended patterns, going from hold sounds to stop sounds, introducing vowels in a particular combination. This is called the vowel circle. So for children who have a hard time discriminating between vowel sounds, because vowel sounds are very nuanced, and there are just these slight differences between vowel sounds that can be a real sticking point for a lot of children, using their articulatory processes will help them hear and feel the difference. For example, with the sound I, the short I sound, everyone say I. Your teeth are bared, your cheeks are taut, you're pulling your sound all the way back. Where if you say ah, you're making a very different formation with your mouth. Now for tier two children who are having trouble discriminating between sounds, using a mirror, using the formation, that's all gonna help scaffold their understanding. So this is information that classroom teachers can have and they can use it in their tiered support. In terms of a routine, there are many different routines available for teaching phonemic awareness. And there isn't one great routine. There are just characteristics of routines that are really important. The first piece, again, is you always want to review. You're always reviewing, cycling back to the information. You never assume that because you've taught this skill to the child yesterday, they now have it mastered. You're always, especially with young children, you know, they're consolidating so much information in a day, you really want to give them a chance to build mastery, and that's just by constant exposure. The gradual release, as I discussed, visual supports. This is not a memory task, this is a sound analysis task. If you have no visual supports, if you don't have a picture of a fig or a picture of a cowboy, then what you're doing is you're tasking the child's memory. You're not just isolating their sound knowledge. So you always want to have the visual aids. Using manipulatives is a good way for children to indicate that they're able to discriminate between sounds, that they're able to identify how many sounds are in a word without using any letters. And again, the chance to overlearn, trying to break up the opportunities of instruction over the course of the day so that they're cycling back to these ideas within a 6-hour time block. There are a number of different phonemic awareness programs. I thought of them as kind of falling into these two categories. There are those that are a full curricula, which means that it's the manual and it's the visuals and the materials that you're going to be using. And there aren't that many phonemic awareness full curricula. Eileen Catazzoni is a reading specialist in Arlington. I know many of her colleagues are here today. She and I work together a bit, but mostly she in developing this program called the Just Right Phonemic Awareness Curriculum. She's now selling it, but it's a valid and great curriculum. It's not published by one of these giant educational publishers, but it's a really wonderful systematic approach. Read Naturally has a new phonemic awareness program called Phonemics. Oh, Read Naturally. You're such jokers. So I know Rebecca Brand is piloting it. She's in the early stages of pilot. I don't know if you want to speak to it at all later on, Rebecca, when you're on the panel. Lingua Systems has Sounds Abound. I know some of you have been using that. There, you know, no one program is perfect. So you want to think about, again, what is going to be the most practical for your educators to do? Is it going to be practical for them to have a workbook and have to pull all of the associated images and picture cards? Or is it going to be, and for some that is manageable, or is it going to be more practical for them to have a box curriculum? Lots of good workbooks. Marilyn Yeager Adams has Phonological Awareness for Young Children, Florida Center for Reading Research, and Michael Hegarty has the Phonemic Awareness workbook. Okay, so let's move on to talk about oral language. I'm just going to take a drink of my giant bottle of water. Okay. So why do we think about speaking? And Nadine referred to this when she talked about the importance of oral language. So we know that when you're reading, you're using your language skills to help you understand what is in print. But what I think is a really key statistic to keep in mind is that readers have to understand 90% of words in a text before they can comprehend its meaning. They cannot be encountering one word after another that they're trying to learn and then still be asked to understand what the story was about. So they need that really strong and deep vocabulary knowledge. And if they're not coming to you with that knowledge, then you need to find ways in which you can support the development of that knowledge. And then what will happen is as they advance in reading, they'll learn new meanings from all of the contextual cues that they use. So context cues usually help knowing what a narrative structure is, knowing what a sentence structure is, what word would make sense there, what could this word possibly mean? Is it describing a noun? Is it a verb? So all of that language knowledge is going to further support reading development. One aspect of vocabulary knowledge that we focus on pretty strongly here at our Center for Reading and Language Research at Tufts is semantic richness. So we want to know not just how many words does a child know, not the breadth of their vocabulary, but how much do they know about each word, the depth of their knowledge. Do they know synonyms? Do they know antonyms? And do they know multiple meanings? So the more, when you're working with children and you're trying to develop their oral language knowledge in Tier 2 instruction, you always want to move from the known to the unknown. So you want to exploit the child's existing background knowledge, their personal experiences. You're saying to them, tell me what you know. Have you ever done this? To describe that to me. Did it feel like this? Did it feel like that? That's your hook into their existing language knowledge, and then you're going to layer on top of it new knowledge and new understanding. That's the basis of assimilation and accommodation. You want to support their comprehension through explicit instruction around narrative structure, visualizing, perspective taking, and vocabulary. And again, the teaching routines for children who have weak language abilities is going to be heavily scaffolded. It's very structured, very standardized, so the child knows every single time what to expect, and there are going to be lots and lots of visual cues. And I say that because for a child with language weaknesses, they often have time with listening comprehension. So the teacher wants to do as little talking as possible. And in order to ensure that the teacher does little talking, the child has to know what's expected. The child has to know the structure. And they have to have visual cues to remind them of strategies. So here's an example of a teaching routine. This is a vocabulary routine. This is using a guided reading lesson to do a vocabulary activity. So say, for example, you're reading with your children Where the Wild Things Are, which is a wonderful book by Maurice Sendak. And first, you ask some prompting questions about the narrative structure. Who can tell me who the characters were? Where did it take place? What was the problem? You might want to use some scaffolds, for example, Story Grammar Marker, that some of you might think of as being a specialized program. is a wonderful tool for scaffolding narrative elements. Has anyone used this program before, Storygrammer, Mark? Okay, lots of familiarity. For those of you who don't know, this is Brady the Story Braid. He's like a little totem, basically a yarn braid. And he has these different icons. And every time a child sees these icons, it reminds them to think of a different element of the narrative structure. Now, you don't have to use Story Grammar Marker, but I think what this is giving us is a framework for how we can approach instruction. It doesn't just have to be the reading specialist or the speech and language pathologist that uses this approach. Classroom teachers can use this kind of scaffold. So every time he sees, for example, the face, you're thinking of who the characters were. Every time the teacher puts this star on, it prompts a discussion about the setting, and so on and so forth. The next piece of the, so you read it, you ask the child these questions. The next piece would be thinking about vocabulary, because again, vocabulary gives us so much advantage in terms of reading. So thinking of a vocabulary word that is particularly rich, and I always look for what's called polysemous words, not to be confused with polygamous words. So polysemy means that it has many interesting meanings. So about 40% of the English language has more than one meaning. So fall and trip and jam and ham and dig. All of these words have more than one meaning. And for children to think flexibly about these words and have a deep level of knowledge really supports their automaticity with reading and their comprehension. So what I would do in order to help a child think about the multiple meanings and to deepen their vocabulary is something called a word web activity. So there's a line in Where the Wild Things Are where it says, Max wears his wolf suit. So I would choose a word like suit, because suit is a polysemous word. And we would do a word web activity with suit. So the way that we do a word web activity is we take a web. And we use a word web because a word web is a way to show that things are connected to each other, that all of these words are connected, just like a spider, you know, weaves a web so that she can connect a trap that can catch bugs. We're showing how words are connected in this trap. So for example, with suit, as a teacher, I might say, the suit that Max was wearing, what was that? You know, it was kind of like a special outfit, like a costume. And then I would use prompting words, and I would model for the child all of my different associations with that word. So how does a suit make you feel when you wear it? Well, sometimes it can be uncomfortable, especially if you have to wear a suit for a special occasion. You're not used to wearing something that's kind of constricted. Sometimes you have to wear a necktie with a suit. What does it look like? Where might you wear a suit? What another place you might wear a suit is work. Children might say, oh yeah, my dad wears a suit when he goes to work, or I saw my cousin wearing a suit at a wedding. He walked down the aisle. You might wear a special wolf suit if you're dressing up, a suit of armor. These are all these associations that you can be eliciting from children, and you're deepening and deepening and deepening their vocabulary knowledge, and you're supporting their comprehension. They don't realize all of these things are connected. You're explicitly showing them that through this kind of activity. And you, if you have a tablet or something, you could be pulling up images of all of these different things kind of on the fly as connections come up. Night, scuba, lots and lots of ideas. So then what I would do is I would lead them through the idea, or I would explicitly teach them that suit can also mean like if something fits you. Like we sometimes say in English, oh, that suits you. Like, that's a good fit. Like, you look nice. It's a compliment. So when might we say that? We might say it when somebody looks nice, or they might, when something suits you and it fits you right, it feels nice. It feels good. You're using these question words to really help draw out and expand their understanding, because more often than not, children with limited vocabulary or limited oral language restrict the words that they use, right? They kind of recycle these words over and over again. And what you're showing them is that there's much more here. You just need to draw it out of them. You need to make it explicit through a scaffold. So for example, if you know the word suit, suit is one word. But if you know suit, you know 20 words. And that's a great idea to show. And what happens with these activities is then kids like to try and beat the number of words that they did last time in the word web. So we hang up these word webs, and they like to compete with themselves about how many words they know. So a word web activity is a really quick, great tier two teaching routine. Then you want to go back to the passage, and you want to reread it, and again, ask the child to decide to define what meaning of suit. So you're building in all these opportunities for review and overlearning. In terms of explicit language programs, there are more explicit language programs that as a, whether you're a classroom teacher or a specialist, you can borrow elements of these programs, even in your classroom routine, with the example of Story Grammar Marker. So Story Grammar Marker is a full curriculum. Project Read has some great explicit language components around narratives. They call, the narrative piece is called Story Form. The nonfiction piece is called Report Form. And then Linda Mood Bell has the Visualizing and Verbalizing. And then there are all sorts of workbooks. I love the Joan Sedita Keys to Literacy workbook for older students. There are lots and lots of different ideas and activities for developing oral language knowledge. Okay. And then finally, we're going to move into what is the complication with print. And here we have the great Steven Pinker, and who is a linguist at Harvard University. And Steven Pinker has this wonderful quote that says, "Children are wired for sound, but print is an optional accessory that must be painstakingly bolted on." What do you think he means by that? What does it mean to be wired for sound? Yes. Exactly. In fact, we don't even say language. I mean, we say language learning when it's a foreign language, but we say language acquisition, right? It's like you put a child in a language-rich environment, and do-do-do-do-do-do-do, like magic. For most kids, they develop language. We are born with these neurons that are specifically designed to process language. But as we said, we're not born to read. And this idea of learning the print word, taking your language skills and applying them to print, can be a very painstaking process. For some children, it can be more painstaking than others. And these are the children who struggle with rapid naming. So let's talk a little bit about what rapid naming is. Rapid naming, or naming speed, is a marker. So a naming speed is a little window into the retrieval network of the child. So it's what it's telling you is that when this child or student is presented with a symbol, so with four-year-olds, we can present them with colors and objects, four and five-year-olds, and then as children get older, we can present them with letters and numbers, and then we can alternate letters and numbers. When they're presented with these symbols, how quickly can they retrieve the verbal label? That's what you're asking them to do. And what you're interested in is the speed. How labored is this process? And these tasks are designed to elicit stamina. We want kids to dig deep when they have to do these tasks. We want to see how automatic is this for them? How much effort do they have to put towards it? Because the more effort they have to put towards this type of task, the more effortful reading, the process of reading is going to be for them. And the less likely they'll be able to hold on to the content. If they're exerting a lot of energy towards the process of reading, even if they have the skills, they're not going to be able to hold on to the content. So this measure tends to be very predictive of children who go on to have fluency issues. And what's important to know about this measure is it's separate from decoding. So you might have children on your caseload, in your school, in your classroom, that are good decoders. They're looking good. They've got phonological awareness. They look good in terms of decoding. And then all of a sudden, in second grade, things tend to fall apart. You can identify those kids before anything falls apart in second grade through a naming speed task. because if a child performs in the below average range or in the cutoff on a naming speed task, they are definitely going to go on to have fluency issues. It's a very, very sensitive and reliable measure. Students who struggle in this area need to overlearn skills, and that starts with phonological awareness. So you don't want to wait. So let's just do a naming speed task. Hey, let's just do one while we're here, right? As a group, let's see. I've done this at different locations. I was just in Atlanta doing this with a group. Their time, I won't tell you what their time was, but let's see if we can beat Atlanta, okay? All right, so what we're gonna do for a naming speed task is we're gonna start at the O, and we're gonna read across these rows as quickly and accurately as we can, okay? Who's gonna time us? Who's gonna volunteer to time us? Okay, great, Leandra. Okay, is everyone ready? Okay, Leandra's getting her timing ready. All right, are you ready? And begin. OASTPAOSPDSDAPDOAPSOAOSP. Wow. Oh my God. They were 22. This is a new record. Amazing. You guys are amazing naming speakers. That's hard, right? You had to dig deep to do that. So the important piece about a naming speed measure, naming speed measures are not part of many of the common benchmark assessments or screening tools like the Dibbles and the AIMSWeb. We'll talk about those a little bit more. They kind of conflate letter naming and naming speed, like how quickly can you recognize letters. What this is doing is it's taking five letters and it's presenting them in serial order. So it's the same symbol, just presented over and over and over again. And that particular process, especially when it's 50 items tends to be the criteria that's necessary to elicit stamina from students. And that's the important piece in sensitivity and validity. So this kind of measure is a really important measure to include in a battery if it's not already part of your screening tool. So what happens with kids who have naming speed deficits? I think this little vignette from I Love Lucy perfectly characterizes what it feels like for a child who has naming speed deficits. For those of you who are not familiar, this is a television program called I Love Lucy featuring Lucille Ball and her wacky neighbor Ethel, and they get into all sorts of hijinks. In this episode, they are working in a chocolate factory. They've scored the ideal job of wrapping up chocolates as they come down the conveyor belt. And what I want you to think about as we're watching this is how does this relate to kids who have retrieval issues, okay, or processing weaknesses. Let me play this for you.
All right, girls, listen carefully. This is the wrapping department.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, the candy will pass by on this conveyor belt and continue into the next room where the girls will pack it. Now, your job is to take each piece of candy and wrap it in one of these papers and then put it back on the belt. You understand?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll! Let her roll! Well, wait here. Somebody's asleep at the switch.
What are you doing up here? I thought you were downstairs boxing chocolates.
Oh, they kicked me out of there fast.
Why?
I kept pinching them to see what kind they were. This is the fourth department I've been in.
Oh, I didn't do so well either.
No. All right, girls. Now, this is your last chance. If one piece of candy gets past you and into the packing room unwrapped, you're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Oh, this is easier. Yeah, we can handle this, okay?
Oh,
you're doing splendidly. Speed it up a little!
Do they have the skills? Yes. They have the skills. They can wrap the chocolates. What's the problem? They can't keep up, right? It's just not automatic enough. And that's really the issue with naming speeds, naming speed deficits on their own, is that the children have the skills, it's just that the retrieval of it is the bottleneck. And so it's too labored, and they can't keep up with the text. And everything's fine as long as the text are at a fairly simple level. But once the text develops in complexity, that's when things start to fall apart. So that's why naming speed deficits tend to emerge later. But you can screen them in kindergarten. Okay, so one piece of critical information that teachers need to know who are supporting children with naming speed deficits is that to become fluent readers, children need automatic word knowledge. They need to know every aspect of a word in order to support the retrieval of their entire reading circuit. And they need to connect that information together. So oftentimes, fluency is approached just with practice, right? Like repeated readings, like, oh, you just need to read, and I'm going to show you, I'm going to model prosody for you. We're going to read this repeatedly. For children with naming speed deficits, what they really need is a connection between all these levels of word knowledge. I'm going to talk about word knowledge in a minute. Repeated reading is a strategy, but it's not going to be the only strategy that these children need. So I brought along this creepy possum with me for a reason, not just because I like to carry around stuffies. So this possum is an acronym to remember the five critical aspects of linguistic knowledge. So in any word, there are all of these sources of information that we're using when we're reading. And if we know those sources of information, it'll help our retrieval. The first one is the phonology. Those are the sounds. We talked about phonology with phonological awareness. The second one are letter patterns. So when we match up sounds and letter patterns, we get phonics. So that's our ability to decode the word, right? Our recognition of the common letter patterns and being able to sound them out. Then there's our semantic knowledge, vocabulary. We just spent some time talking about vocabulary. That's supporting our word reading. Then there's our syntactic knowledge. That's how the sentence is put together. When we have syntactic knowledge, we can predict what the next word's going to be. That's what like a daze or a close passage is based on. And then there's morphology. Morphology is the roots and the endings, so that you know that if you have a specific ending on a word, for example, putting ed on a root word like jam, you're putting it into the past tense. All of that knowledge is supporting the reading ability. And all of that knowledge, who got that bow on that possum? That's what I want to know. Is happening in your reading circuit. So you just saw all of these beautiful images direct from the research that has been done by Nadine and her colleagues. If we were to kind of simplify this a bit, what we see are these possum components are happening across the reading circuit. And if we want to increase retrieval, we want to teach across the components in a given lesson. We want to activate all this word knowledge in a given lesson. So when you're doing a repeated reading activity, that's activating some knowledge, but not all. So here's an example of a fluency routine that really works to try and develop all the aspects of possum. So for example, I might start out with a student by selecting some letter patterns. And I would choose these letter patterns from the phonics works that we're doing. For example, here we have letter patterns or short vowel like OB, OB, or UN. You can also get, these dice are available through really good stuff, but you can buy blank dice on Amazon and they're like $5. So you can just put letter patterns on there, you can customize your word dice. You could also do this with word cards. But basically what you want to do is you want to isolate the rhyme pattern and the starter sound so that children are beginning to read in efficient chunks. So they're not just looking at, this is if they already need to have some knowledge about individual sounds and their individual letters and their corresponding sounds, but now you're moving them to a next level. You're moving them to the onset rhyme level. So you have your onset dice in blue and your rhyme dice in red, or you can customize it, or you can use word cards, or you have some word cards that are rhyme and some word cards that are onset, and you're having them just quickly build words. And every word that they build, you have them write it on a post-it note. So for example, they build words like, they're practicing with their SL blend, and they're building words like slip and slap and slup. They're making real words, they're making non-words, they're just building words with these rhyme patterns. And they're writing them down, so they're getting this extra practice, right? The grapheme piece is involved too. If the grapheme piece is too complicated, you can scribe. But the idea is that you have a record of the words that they're making. Then they have a whole group of post-its that you've created, and they're gonna read through those words. So they've built them, they've written them, they're reading through them. You're building over-learning activities into the lesson. Then you ask them to sort by the meaning. So this is the semantic piece. You're saying, of those words that you just made, which ones are real words, like slop and slap and slip and rip and slug and slam, and which ones are non-words? So you're activating the semantic piece of their network, like fip and slin and gip. And then you're asking them to work on their syntactic knowledge by taking a word and making a sentence out of it. Do not slam the door shut. Slip on your shoes. Lunch tastes like slop. So you're all, just in this few steps, you're addressing all the possum components, or many of the possum components of language. You could also do this activity with endings. So if you wanted to work on morphology, you could do root words and endings. You could break this up in whatever, or syllables. You could break this up in whatever way that you want. But you're thinking about chunks, because chunks of words, rather than individual sounds, build automaticity. Ideally, we want the child to see the word and read it automatically, but the step between individual sounds and reading whole words is breaking them up into chunks. Then you can put these words, just like we did a RAN chart for letters and colors, you can put these words in basically RAN chart order. And you're just having them read across. You're maybe choosing a few of them. You're making some duplicates. So for example, I have slip on there twice. I have slam on there twice. I have slap on there twice. So they're just reading across. This is building some of the accuracy and the automaticity. Slip, slam, slug, slap, slop. And you might be doing this and having a group participate. Individual students might be doing this part, whatever works for you. And then finally, you're applying the strategy to connected text. So you're bringing in a text, whether it's a decodable or a leveled text. You're taking out your highlighter tape, which is a great tool for having children focus in on a particular strategy, but without ruining, you know, the book. And you're having them highlight things that you've just been practicing, whether it's rhyme patterns or blends, or they're highlighting endings, or they're highlighting nouns. Whatever you've been discussing with them, that's what they're highlighting. So right there, you've addressed many of the possum components in a quick routine. And this is a way to help really activate the entire reading circuit. One thing to say is whenever I have children read in a group, in a small group, I always have them preview it silently, ask me a question, and then read aloud. Unless I'm assessing them. Basically, this is a version of what we do in this program called RAVO. So we've developed a curriculum called RAVO. I know many of you are familiar with the curriculum. Some of you are using it. What RAVO has done is it has just identified all the words for you. It's identified all the multiple meanings of words. It's broken up words into onset and rhyme, and you have cards for it. It has all of these strategies and components around adding endings, and then it has the books for connected text. So if you've heard about RAVO and you're interested, this is kind of the basis of RAVO. It really was designed for kids who have naming speed deficits. If you're thinking about examples of explicit systematic fluency programs, the multi-componential approach is really for this age, for second through fifth, is really RAVO. Other programs that do repeated reading really well are programs like Great Leaps and Read Naturally. And of course, you can pull from some of these programs and add in the other elements that we talked about, like the word dice and that sort of thing. So just to review what we've been talking about, at the kindergarten level, I mean, explicit, systematic phonological awareness is so key. I think the importance of it really cannot be understated. And that is partially because you can't go back. It's really hard to teach a second grader or a third grader phonological or phonemic awareness. Kindergarten is the ideal time to do that. Routines that extend guided reading to build vocabulary can help support language development. So you're using these elements of your tier one instruction and you're building off of them. And rapid naming skills predict later reading fluency. So thinking about rapid naming as a critical piece in your screening is really, really essential. And trying to address all the possum elements in fluency routines will help the retrieval.